Well, good afternoon and welcome to the Dean's lecture tonight, this afternoon. I'm Dr. Daniel Blankenship, I'm the Provost and Dean of the College. This is the first 2016-17 Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture Series. So welcome to that event tonight, this afternoon. For 36 years, this interdisciplinary lecture series has showcased the talent and the depth of the faculty at Eureka College. Thanks to the generosity of the Noe family, as usually represented by Charlotte Noe, Dean Noe's wife. And I think she's not able to be here tonight. She's often attends these events. The Dean's Lecture Series was begun by Dean Jerry D. McCoy in 1980, and he is here tonight. Thank you for being here tonight. He's sitting by Harry, in case you wondered. The series was created to stimulate discussion among the college faculty and to offer enrichment to students and friends of the college. In 1992, the Dean's Lecture Series was renamed in honor of the late Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who served as academic dean from 1955 to 1977. The series continues through gifts made by family and friends. Throughout the history of the series, special emphasis has been given to lecture topics reaching across academic fields quite broadly. Today we'll be hearing from three of our faculty, and I'll introduce them. First, Associate Professor of Education, Lisa Cheek. Lisa earned a Bachelor's in Elementary Education from Taylor University and a Master's in Teaching and Leadership from St. Xavier University. She provides professional development training of the co-teaching model in the student teaching setting and has worked as a consultant for co-teachers in local schools. Now, Assistant Professor of Education, Janelle Dies. Janelle earned a Bachelor's in Elementary Education from Bradley, a Master's in Curriculum and Instruction, and a Master's in Instructional Technology and Design from Illinois State University. Janelle also holds a National Board Teacher Certification, a designation for public school educators who meet rigorous standards in intensive study, expert evaluation, self-assessment, and peer review. We also have Associate Professor of Special Education, Dr. Deborah Loomis. Deborah earned her Bachelor's in Special Education from Illinois State, a Master's from Northeastern Illinois University in Learning Disabilities, an Administrative Certificate from Illinois State University, and an EDD from Argosy University. She brings her knowledge of special education to higher education from a background as a special education teacher, coordinator, and administrator in public education. With that, I invite you to welcome Lisa Cheek, Janelle Dies, and Deb Loomis today.
Thank you. Welcome to our Dean's Lecture this afternoon. And we thank you for attending. We, as we showed on that video, want to just thank all of you who are educators, and we want to thank you for making a difference in our students' lives. And as we participated this year in identifying some of the things that we have done last year, we have just been very impressed by all that we know educators do for students. So I am Lisa Cheek, and I, as was introduced, am an associate professor here at the college and taught 17 years in the field prior to being here.
My name is Janelle Dies. I'm assistant professor of education. This is my eighth year at the college, and before here, I taught 10 years in public education.
I'm Deb Loomis, and I've been here 10 years and spent 20 years in public education. Our story really begins in 2008. In 2008, Eureka Special Education became involved with four other institutions in the Chicago area in a federal grant for transforming special education. Through that grant, we brought in over $67,000 to the Eureka Education Program. The grant was quite unique with five different institutions, and that's one of the reasons that we were able to get it. Through that grant, we also were able to purchase training from the University of Kansas, from the Kansas Center on Research and Learning. During that five-year grant, we also were awarded 2 years of the Doing What Works grant. And you'll be hearing more about SIM very shortly. Okay. Part of the grant was to improve education programs to the point where students were getting more instruction on evidence-based practice. And in order to do that, we looked at incorporating these five things that you see on the screen. The first was universal design for learning. Universal design gives access to the general curriculum for students with disabilities. Just as the curb cuts help mothers with strollers or fathers with strollers and bicyclists, the curriculum that is specifically designed for all children in a diverse classroom, that helps everyone.
The next one that I'm going to talk about is this Charlotte Danielson model. This is pretty much the framework that practicing teachers are assessed on, and it's pretty common within schools within Illinois for teachers to be assessed on these four domains. Basically, within these four domains, teachers are provided and required to have evidence of how they teach and how they provide evidence within those four domains. The four domains are planning and preparation, classroom environment, instruction, and professional responsibilities. Here at Eureka, within our 400-level coursework, we work very hard to make sure that our students get early understandings of what the Charlotte Danielson model is, since they will obviously be assessed on that during their first years of teaching. And then we also make sure that during their student teaching semester, we have one key assessment tool, which has been aligned to Danielson. So they kind of understand the expectations that they have and how their work and how their teaching needs to align to Danielson.
During our preparation of the grant work that we did, we were looking at the field and what's happening in the field and the best practices there. And the third item that we wanted to identify from best practices is the co-teaching approach to education. and to instruction. And Deb and I were trained in that model at the University of Kansas, and we are still part of the Trainer of Trainers program. And co-teaching model identifies that there are more effective ways in using two teachers in a classroom than for one to stand and deliver information and content and for the other to just be an aid. So on this slide, you notice that there are other means by which two teachers in a classroom can be more effective. And so we train, currently we've been doing this for the past 5 years, we've been training our students, our teacher candidates, in the co-teaching model, and they come along with their co-teacher, who they're assigned with in student teaching, and they then are trained together in how to best implement the co-teaching approaches, and they learn how and when to select those for meaningful instructional practices within their classroom, which engage students and developed more intensive student engagement and achievement. So this is something that we continue on, and we've been very pleased with the progress and what we see in using that approach. And we currently are the only teacher prep program within the region that implements the co-teaching model.
The strategic instruction model is the first of the University of Kansas learning strategies that we were involved with. Lisa Cheek and I went to receive that training, and we incorporate the storage, written expression, acquisition, and cooperative thinking strands into our coursework. Those strategies can be used from early elementary all the way up through the college level. A couple years after we received our training in that learning strategies curriculum, we went back for the content enhancement routines. And it was the three of us that attended that training. That training is intended for higher grade levels, junior high, senior high, and can even be used at the college level. Through that training, I was able to continue my work with the University of Kansas, and now I am a professional developer in those strategies for them.
Our last one within this category is data driven decision making. This visual shows you one of the engagement guides that we created through our grant with Doing What Works. The reason why we picked this one, because it shows one of the many opportunities that we provide our students to try to take data and then act and react upon decisions. In this model, the students would then watch a video and then provide evidence through the video on how they would act or react to teaching. Because we know that good teachers see a need, develop data, look at that data, and then take action. So we try a lot of different strategies within our program to allow students to make data-driven decisions.
So all of that was a little bit of background knowledge for how we developed this continual work that we did all of last school year with District 140, the local school district in Eureka here. And all of that prior knowledge we kind of put together, and Deb mentioned our story, so this is our kind of backstory to how we began to think about, you know, how do we develop and provide professional training for teachers in the field. So through that process of understanding all of the theory and all of the ways of teaching, it was at that same moment in time in which the Illinois State Board of Education moved professional development training from the housing at the state level to the local level. So we had this thought that maybe our local school district would like a hand in developing some professional development training for their teachers. And so we went to the local superintendent, Bob Bardwell, and asked if he would be interested in partnering with us in this endeavor. And he was very interested, and so we set out, even though we might have been a little crazy at the time, we set out to add a little bit more to our plate, and we filled out the paperwork for the Barton Fellowship, and we got going on planning for this professional development. The summer of 2015, we met multiple times with the district administrators. We listened to their needs and what they were interested in learning about. They chose the textbook, which was High Impact Instruction by Jim Knight, and we then identified what would the content be that we taught out of that text. It was probably through our discussion together that we were trying to identify how could we best help them transform what they did in their district. And we really quickly came to the point where we wanted to implement professional learning communities for their understanding and their use of implementing the textbook of High Impact Instruction. It was kind of eye-opening for us to realize that the administrators did not know what a professional learning community was all about. So we had to take a little bit of time and train them on what a professional learning community is. And they were very on board once they understood that it was going to be the means by which they transform and build a climate for learning within their district and within their teaching. And that became the support system, because they were able to use one another within that building to develop and engage the students more effectively. They now had a common language and a support system that they were building through the use of professional learning communities. So giving you a little bit of a timeline, after the planning of that summer, we met here on our campus. We built the partnership with the college, with the District 140. And so we met with them here. We brought all of their, as you see, all of their teachers, all of their support staff, and all of their administrators to an in-service here on our campus. And that first training was building an understanding of professional learning communities. And we helped them identify the purpose and how they develop a professional learning community and the purpose of what that would give for taking the risk of changing instructional practice. Then at the end of that August seminar, the teachers chose which professional learning community they wanted to be a member of. And it was then in developing those professional learning community teams that we continued helping them throughout the year. So we met in October, in February, and in April, and continued for each of those sessions, helping them understand high impact instruction. And they would then meet once a month in their own districts, and in the professional learning community, they would continue to develop and support one another, talk about instruction, talk about how best to implement the high impact instructional practices that they were learning. At that initial training, we did bring some of our teacher candidates. Most of them at the time were ready to move into student teaching. So they were able to experience a professional development setting with educators in the field. They were able to engage in that discussion a little bit with them. They received the textbook that the district had purchased all of their teachers. And so they were well informed and ready to move forward kind of in their own transforming of themselves from a student to a teacher after participating in that professional development. We continuously, you know, kind of touched base with the teachers throughout the year. In April of last year, we finished up the last session. We did a wrap up with them, and we asked for them to give us some data. And so some feedback we received, we were able to identify the impact that we had upon them and how they were able to make some changes within their district. And in a little while, we'll share some of that data with you. So on the slide, you see the number 145 plus. Since the fall of 2015, we more explicitly have been implementing a lot of this foundational work and some of the experiences that we've learned through the professional development that we provided. We've implemented it more into our coursework and into all of the things that we do within our program for our students. So the plus means it's being carried forward. From here forward, more and more of our students will have the opportunity to get some of this understanding, and hopefully they in their districts, when they get their first job, will be able to implement high impact instruction.
I was first introduced to professional learning communities while working on my dissertation. The title of my dissertation was Exploring the Educational Practices That Positively Impact the Outcomes for Students with Disabilities. So I was on a hunt for that magic bullet, that one method that would improve scores. I had a research site in the northern part of Illinois, one from the central part of Illinois, and one from the southern part of Illinois. All of those districts had high scores for their subgroup of students with disabilities. I didn't find that magic bullet, but what I did find was that two of the groups, the group from northern Illinois and the one from southern Illinois, had functioning professional learning communities as their professional development format. And that was something that was new to me. Then upon looking at things closer, I was able to discover that my third site in central Illinois wasn't calling it a professional learning community, but that is the way a lot of their teachers were learning new things. Many of them were taking a master's program together and working in small groups. Research from the last 20 years has proven that the professional development of one and done doesn't work because it may temporarily increase the knowledge of a teacher, but it never impacts the students. Professional learning communities is a year-long endeavor where the change in teacher knowledge does impact student achievement. Higher effect sizes for professional development have been found when professional development was developed by a university and involved training on practical skills rather than theory. From the slide, professional learning communities defined, it's teachers working together who have a shared mission, vision, values, and goals. The structure is common goals. A lot of our professional learning communities were either grouped together by grade level or by math or science or English. And it's very action-oriented. It was something that the teachers could learn about and attempt to implement in their classes right away.
So in enters the book that we ended up using as our model of the PLC. It was High Impact Instruction by Jim Knight. We were really excited when we found out that this was the text because we quickly discovered that Jim Knight is a researcher and a professional developer from University of Kansas. And as we talked about earlier, we had been trained in those strategic instruction models. And so we really kind of had a nice foundation of what and how Knight kind of structures things. So we were very, very excited about that. And it kind of was a nice blessing to kind of drive the professional development through a text that we really believed in and had good understanding of. We'll talk a little bit about how, in a moment, how the actual text is organized and kind of how we then organized our insights and our work within those sections. So Lisa's going to talk about the big four real quick.
Knight's work defines instruction and some of the ways that learning happens through these big four. And so this was pretty much our foundation. We pulled this from the text and then organized the framework of the professional development learning sessions based on these four. So content planning, instruction, and community building were some of the, well, actually they were the three topics that the teachers could choose from in deciding which team to be a part of. So each teacher chose one part of the book to focus on for the whole year. Formative assessment, we did not choose to pull that out as a separate component for them to think about because we embedded it in the other three, as it was very meaningful to assess each of those other three components. So we used the big four all throughout the sessions, and the teachers continued to go back to that. Every session, we asked them to reflect upon their learning. We asked them to reflect on their impact and how they were implementing things. So we continually to use this kind of as that framework and that foundation that they continually went to identify how am I really implementing things within the classroom. So Deb's going to talk about the professional development map that we used in our initial stage of setting up for the teachers what it is they were going to endeavor for that whole year's work.
This is a course organizer, and this is an enhancement routine from University of Kansas. The top there has high impact instruction. That's our course. And the learning rituals were established on that very first day. The community principles, any classroom has some kind of rules for functioning. So those community principles incorporate SCORE skills, which is another, it's a cooperative thinking strategy. And the first five there, share your ideas, compliment others, offer help or encouragement, recommend changes nicely, and exhibit self-control. Those five are the SCORE skills. And I teach those skills to our elementary ed and special ed students. And it's a way to teach students how to work together. So I've not only taught my college students how to do college work together, but I've trained them in how to train their students to work together, because I don't ever remember being trained in how to work in a group. So this is very basic, but it is a basic skills, a skill for learning how to function as a part of a group. The critical concepts here is a quote we took right from High Impact Instruction. The key to helping teachers achieve their personal best is providing them with effective instructional practices. The book is divided into a planning section, an instruction section, and a community building section. The teachers were asked to pick one of these areas as a focus for their year of professional development. I had planning, Janelle had instruction, and Lisa was responsible for the community building group. The way this chart is organized, it can be used with any course. So any of our college courses could be mapped out for the year. Seeing the overview of a course could help students see the big picture and understand how things go together.
So when we created this professional development series, we knew that we needed to model and simulate things because the whole idea was to take the book and make it come alive. So in one of our first sessions, we kind of held on to that formative assessment that happens within the planning. And we decided to do a series of engagement activities because we quickly realized in Knight's book, engagement is kind of this overarching piece. And he mentions that frequently. How do you get your students engaged? What activities do you create to create engagement? And possibly how could you formally assess that while that occurs? Another thing that we really emphasize in our program is the work by John Hattie and his book called Visible Learning. John Hattie is known for creating a meta-analysis and looking at student engagement through meta-analysis. He really looks at creating things through an effect size of 0.4. So that visual at the bottom of your screen kind of shows what kind of carries through Hattie's work. The 0.4 is right at the top. Your job as a teacher is to try to implement different instructional strategies and teaching that have an effect size of 0.4 or higher. So his book is fascinating on that regard because the whole idea is the higher the effect size, the higher the student achievement, the greater real world learning that can occur. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go through and kind of simulate a few of the five that we had done in that opening professional development series. The five that we covered were choral response, response cards, whiteboards, clickers, and thumbs up and thumbs down. So get ready to move, get ready to get energized, get ready to move your brain a little bit because Lisa's going to start with choral response.
The five that we chose for sampling today can be used at any grade level, even college coursework. Get students thinking, gets them engaged and participating. And when we reflected upon our opening session, this was one part of the session that we felt like the teachers really grasped on to a few things that they could take away on that very first day and start implementing. And we heard over and over throughout the year and as well as this year when we touched base with them to see, you know, what they were doing this year and how we impacted them, they still mentioned that some of these engagements were what they were starting to use within their classrooms. So we are going to I'm going to step away from the microphone a little bit to get you a little bit more engaged. So here we go. I'll shout loud. Versus ask a question and just one person gives a response. So this is our choral response activity. Choral means everybody, so everybody participate. Let me set up the routine. The routine will be when I speak, I'll point to myself. When you speak, I'll point to you, okay? So here we go. The length of Thanksgiving break this year is
One week.
Very good. Continue the pattern. Green, black, white.
Green, black, white.
Very good. Continue this pattern. You're doing awesome. Awesome job. The most famous alum of Eureka College is
Ronald Reagan.
Very good. You'll know that. The season which follows summer is
fall.
The season which follows summer is
autumn.
Oh, very good. Autumn. Row, row, row your boat
gently down the stream.
Merrily, 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 merrily.
Life is but a dream.
You did very nice. Our next sample will be response cards, and those are on your table. So Janelle will drop back.
So all of my questions are true, false.
Oh,
What you will do is, as I ask the question, you will hold up the correct card. Is it true or is it false? Study day this year is on a Thursday. Hold your cards up. Don't cheat from your neighbors. I am very impressed. It is false. It's a Wednesday. Wednesday, December 7th. Very good. Our second question. True or false? Eureka College was the first college in Illinois and the third in the nation to admit men and women on an equal basis. That is true. Very good work. Question three. Mika's Coffee House serves dinner. True. Very good work. Yes. Question four. Eureka, true or false? Eureka was the original name of this town. True or false? It is false. It was Walnut Grove. And question five. Dr. Wright attended the University of Kansas. True or false? True. It is true.
She says true.
No cheating.
You might be thinking that students will just look around and put up the right card. Well, yes, they do that. But now I know that Harry Fisher just learned about that. That's formative assessment. Now Deb's going to talk about clickers.
Hey, clickers is something that I actually use in my class. Sarah sitting here is in one of my classes, so she can attest to that. I do use them for bell ringers. Clickers has these cards, and there are four clicker cards on each table. And we have a table right here that's got some extra people in it. So. If you go to clickers.com, you can print out up to 40 free cards. Each of these cards has a number on it and letters on each side of that code. So I also have the app on my phone. And as soon as Mrs. Dies pulls up the clickers site, there's a question, which is the appropriate feedback if a student makes an error on declarative knowledge? And you have four choices. Pick your choice and then hold your it looks like a QR code. Hold your code so that the letter that you want is on top. And my phone is, now if you can just, is picking up.
Okay, your answers are going up. You can see the check marks. Hold it up, and when Deb comes by, she'll see it.
That's okay. We don't know who you are.
They're anonymous.
They're anonymous.
My entire career is knowing that.
All of the above.
Okay. We got quite a few.
Listen up. Okay.
Okay, Mrs. Dies, go to the graph. Okay, the correct response is A. And for tonight, I just have student one, student two in my phone. But for your class, you would actually have names, so then you could take your phone after class and put it into your grade book.
So it's a pretty great way to quickly assess the knowledge of a group.
So when we look at all of those ways in which we can get our students engaged in high-impact instruction, engagement activities, we gave one example of a response card as true and false, but you can change those for whatever type of answer you want them to have. As we look at other engagement activities, the text has a lot of ways in which Knight describes high-impact instructional activities, and the teachers were really engaged themselves in learning how to implement a variety of different activities at all levels. So I know your cards look like elementary, but even the high school teachers used response cards and they developed cards that were for that level. Now we're going to transition to our analysis. After our sessions, our three sessions with the teachers, in our last session we had given them a survey in April and they filled out information, and Deb's going to talk about the first slide and how it's broken down, and then we will share the rest of the data from that, from our whole year of work.
District 140 put a survey up in Google Docs, and out of 109 teachers, we had 66 teacher responses. Now, again, these teachers were divided between the three focus groups, the planning, instruction, or community building. This is a slide that shows the planning. Out of the people that were working on planning, 29 of them chose to focus on formative assessment. And that's, I'm sorry, the question at the bottom that they needed to respond to was high impact instruction, instructional practices did you try in your classroom? And 29 people talked about formative assessment, those active participation or active engagement activities that we just demonstrated for you were the most frequently mentioned in that. 15 chose to focus on learning maps, and you get much more detailed. I showed you the course organizer, but there's also a chapter organizer that you can use, which is called a unit organizer by the University of Kansas. And there's also a lesson organizer. So it's a way to make the lesson visual for students. Also in that learning maps, I had taught my group how to make mind maps. If you've got students that are very visual or like to doodle, mind mapping is a great way to teach them to take notes. So that was the planning group.
My instruction group, first thing you're going to notice is there's a lot more than 66 responses there, and that's because a lot of people in the instruction tried a lot of different ones. The ones that are hanging kind of high are questions and cooperative learning. Questioning was one that was one of our focus sessions in October. We watched a video on it, they practiced it, so I feel like that probably, the simulation and all of those activities probably made that response high. We also, and we all three did this in all three of our sessions, but we used cooperative learning structures a lot to help them kind of process the information, work together in groups. The PLC was a great vehicle to allow cooperative learning to develop. So that's kind of how the responses fell in the instruction group.
We carried that same question across all of those different PLCs. We wanted to know how all of them were implementing things. And in the community building, it's setting culture, building culture within your environment so that it is a conducive and more effective learning environment. And one of the items that we focused on was how do we provide student that engagement that will also translate to high achieving students. And one of those powerful motivators is choice. And so in
the session that I was teaching with them, we talked about freedom within form. How do teachers keep boundaries even though students have choices? And the powerful understanding of choices, the teachers said even in that session when they were first learning about it, that they were very uncomfortable with providing student choices, especially at the at the high school level. And I was somewhat surprised at that, that they weren't letting their students have some choice in learning. They were really delivering a lot of lecture, teacher-directed instruction. And so even the high school teachers were identifying, even though they were being risk takers, that they wanted to learn more, and they implemented that understanding of freedom within form.
These were their responses for the question, what was the benefit of the professional learning community model over the traditional professional development? Because this is qualitative data, we got a lot of different answers, and I had to go through the data and do some coding. If you notice, the first three to four are really about communicating. The teachers really like to be able to have time to work with other teachers and discuss what they were learning in the book. They were talking things out, exploring solutions to problems in their classrooms. They were collaborating with one another on common problems, and a lot of them were sharing what was working in their classroom, which encouraged other people to attempt new things.
The last question that we asked is how they had grown professionally through this process. And if you really look at the high ideas here, the new ideas, the relationships, the cooperative learning kind of falling kind of high up there, we really believe that those tie very strongly to the previous question that Deb was talking about the PLC model, that collaboration, that sharing, that working together piece. And that was the foundation which allowed them to maybe grow more professional, at a higher level professionally than maybe if they just read the book on their own.
So our story started with an idea, looking at what was going on in the field, looking at identifying how things are changing within education. And even though it was a long year and it was a lot of planning and a lot of time spent together working, it was a rewarding year. We saw a lot of growth and a lot of ways in which we touched the district and the teachers. And as we reflected upon the work last year even, we looked at, you know, really we had an impact in these four ways. We looked at our program. Our current program has been under revision, and this is the first semester that it's fully been implemented. And so starting to, you know, use what we know and what we've learned to implement and revise and really fine-tune our program. So that's an ongoing component, but it has impacted what we do here in our work at the college. Our individual teacher candidates we've also impacted because we've been able to take this work into our specific courses. We changed the practica model from a field experience model, and we've given our teacher candidates an understanding of language that we're teaching them things that when they're placed in District 140, they will see it in action. They will see the high impact instruction there in the field. And so we feel that that's a really strong benefit for our students in learning how to teach their own future students, which then ties into the impact that we have within the district, the local teachers and the administration, building a stronger partnership, and they too feel like they know a little bit more about what we expect from our students. So when they go into their classrooms, they can, again, have that same language to talk about. And then our own scholarly work, we continue to grow and develop in this area of all of these components, especially the changes in the field. And it is a model, this professional development training we feel that we could replicate in other districts. So we were very pleased, we're gratified with the work that we achieved with the district. And one other step that we wanted to make sure that we didn't forget was to touch base with the district this year. So just a month ago, we started to inquire what's happening in their district as a result of our work with them last year. And again, it was very meaningful to hear that they have carried on with that work and what we have given them to think about. And so we wanted you to hear from them. So this is.
Tony, what do you think this one means? What type of instruction is most beneficial for students? How do students learn best? How does one know if students are learning? What factors positively impact the learning environment? These are some of the questions at the heart of education reform. Research shows that students learn best when teachers implement effective instructional practices as a result of ongoing professional development training. As of 2015, the Illinois State Board of Education now requires teacher professional development be under the purview of local school districts. And knowing this, Eureka College education professors Lisa Cheek, Janelle Dies, and Deb Loomis set out to provide professional development training in partnership with local school district CUSD 140. During the 2015-16 school year, administrators, faculty, and staff of District 140 met with professors for training in high-impact instructional practices supported through the implementation of professional learning communities. This work was made possible through the Eureka College Fund for the Advancement of Excellence in Learning, Service, and Leadership, and the Barton Fund Faculty Fellowship.
The model that Eureka College professors provided was a great example of how a PLC should run. And then last year we had a chance to, practice is the wrong word, but had a chance to meet with other teachers and participate in a PLC. And then this year we had a chance to determine what PLC groups we were in. And we wanted to be in the math PLC, so we had a chance to get together with the other math teachers in the building and discuss and then use the model that was given to us last year from your college professors to help us run a program that's beneficial and helps us become better math teachers.
We have two mentor teachers in our PLC and then their two mentees. Because we recently just hired a new math teacher this year and then for eighth grade 2 years ago for our sixth grade math teacher. And so we've had to observe those new teachers teaching a lesson and give them feedback. And it's been very beneficial as a mentor teacher being able to see that new teacher teaching. I've gotten some new insight for me in how I can take things that I've seen from his lessons into my classroom. And I'm also able then to offer feedback for him as well. And just have an open discussion of, you know, what works, what maybe we can improve on. And it just gives you a whole new perspective. And like I said, not only for that mentee where I'm observing his lesson, but I also, I benefit from it as well because then I'm learning some tips, tricks, techniques that I can take back for me.
With the Charlotte Danielson method, one of the main things is giving the students the opportunity to become a bigger part of their classroom, a bigger part of their learning, and to have awareness of their process. So instead of just being doers, they have to be thinkers of what they're doing. We introduced abbreviations, and they're just identifying words that needed to be abbreviated. And as the students were creating their abbreviations, they had a resource, but after creating their work, many students didn't understand little details like states only need two capitals, no period, or that when you're doing the abbreviation for avenue, it's one capital and period. So there were different details that we needed to address because there was confusion. So in the lesson today, we tried to implement student engagement. So with the sticky notes, I put 21 sticky notes around the room that had different abbreviations, states, months, days of the week, people and places, and streets. So then they could see how the abbreviation was to be written correctly. And they would go around the room and they would find their sticky note. Then after the sticky note search, we joined at the carpet, and I had them talk with their neighbors, and they were to identify what category is my sticky note. And after doing that, they were to place their sticky note in the appropriate category on the graphic organizer. we spoke about, as they were placing their sticky notes, we spoke how the abbreviation was written and the common mistakes that were made so that when they were doing their abbreviations today, they would have a better understanding of those mistakes and hopefully learn from their mistakes. That's kind of in our classroom. And it also goes along with tonight that if we create a community where we learn that mistakes are bad, the students will never learn from them. And instead, we focus on mistakes or opportunities to learn. And having that mentality, that switch of, oh, I got an F on my paper, I will never learn this. They say, oh, I got an F on my paper, I need to correct this, to learn from this.
Jim Knight's research in high impact instruction is meaningful at all grade levels, elementary school, middle school, and high school.
Because of the PLC last year, we spent a lot of time talking about everything from how we think out and teach behavior expectations to what content is most important. And I spent some time in the summer going through and looking at what content is really essential and most important, and what stuff is really not authentic, real, applicable, and engaging. And I was able to get rid of a lot of stuff and add more projects that were real life, real world, and maybe enhance some of the things that I was already doing.
The high impact instruction PLC groups from last year and some of the strategies that you guys gave us in the groups made me very aware of my teaching and of what students were doing in the classroom rather than like what I was doing. So I tried out the slips of paper. You cut up slips of paper and it had a different question on each one, and then it would rotate through a student asking a question and then a student giving an answer and then the next student doing something. And so I tried that out, and just to get all the students participating, that was one of the biggest things that I benefited from with the PLCs, was being aware of my own lessons and being aware of total student engagement instead of just small individuals.
When I look at our teachers involved in the PLCs, what I see now are teachers that feel empowered. They feel empowered to make decisions regarding their own professional development. No longer do we have a top-down model. The model that we're using through high-impact instruction is one in which teachers identify and make decisions and then guide the road ahead towards implementing their professional development.
We have many PLCs, and one of them this year is focusing on assessment. And with the transition from the ACT in the state of Illinois to the SAT, we're learning together. And the PLC on assessment is focusing on how we can best implement practice in our classroom to prepare kids for an assessment like the SAT so they can do their best. And not just your high-performing kids, we're talking about all kids across the board.
Professional learning communities has really become the culture of our district at this time. It's really the main focus of our professional development. We still offer or allow teachers to go to a one-day workshop or go to a reading conference if they choose. But really the main thrust of our professional development is through the professional learning communities. And this year, every teacher has chosen a professional learning community that is of their interest or an area where they feel like they should improve. And then even our administrative team is participating in a professional learning community.
We meet every week, every Wednesday over lunch, and we go over our student growth framework. If one of us has been to a workshop, we share what we've learned, and we talk about what's working and what's not working, and we tweak the framework if we need to, and then other ideas in the classroom as well. So without that weekly communication, I don't feel like any of us would be as strong as we are, all of us together. I feel like I'm better at differentiating. I'm getting ideas from everybody. This year I have an inclusion classroom, and so having the special ed teacher in with me, I'm doing things a lot differently than what I've done before. And anytime I hear an idea from somebody else, it always sounds like a good one, and so I can't wait to try it in my classroom. And so every day is different, every year is different, and this year I think I'm doing the best probably I've ever done, just even at the differentiating part. And that's kind of the main goal of when we meet every Wednesday, because we have so many needs.
I feel like I've grown a lot. I've been lucky enough that I've been on three or four different teams. So I've been on our co-teaching team. I've been on our second grade PLC team. I've been on our, this year I'm on our third grade. I've been on our RTI team. So for me, I feel like personally I've been able to grow quite a bit. I also feel like I've been an asset to the other teams with my special ed background. I could give them support. I feel like we are doing a better job of differentiating the home learners, not just the low learners, the areas of concern learners.
Some of the high impact strategies I think that I have been able to observe throughout all of them is specifically planning for differentiation. And the teachers are all making a plan and working their plan as far as differentiation goes. So the planning aspect really helped with that. Also, we have created a learner-friendly culture. We've had this for a long time here, but I think it's just really enhanced some of the things and reinforced some of the things that we do. Our PBIS team consistently is looking at what the kids need, providing lessons for them based upon what we see kids needing throughout our building, and we're consistently recognizing positive behaviors, which really adds to the positive culture of our school.
We were excited to work with Eureka College, but we didn't know what it would look like the next year. In fact, whether we would even continue with our professional learning communities, we're limited our time in terms of professional development time. We have a lot of other, projects going on in our district that we feel are valuable, but after spending that year doing this, we felt that this moved to the top. And so we kept the same structure, the same format that we learned last year from Eureka College. But then we did give the teachers the freedom to go out and pursue an area that they wanted to improve on.
Well, obviously, it helped us build a stronger relationship with the teacher education department. Eureka College is a great asset right here in our community. It's something that we should be tapping into more. I think that both parties learn from each other. You know, as we went through this, we obviously learned from you guys, the professors that put on the professional development. But I also believe that you learn from us. I think that's just part of a professional, larger professional learning community as a whole. And I believe that can continue in greater ways in the future.
My name is C.G. Moore, and I'm the class of 2006, and I first came to Eureka in 2000.
Stopping that. That's good advertising. That concludes our presentation for today. We just want to kind of finish up with thanking so many people that were involved in the process. The people up here that we're mentioning are people that helped us either with the professional development piece, because the year-long professional development just took a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of people, and there were also a lot of people that helped us with making sure that the presentation tonight, the lecture tonight and this afternoon went well. So give thanks to all of these people. And we also wanted to give recognition to Mr. Glenn Barton. As you know, he passed away last month. He is a wonderful supporter of Eureka College and, most importantly, our department. We have students every semester that receive the Barton Scholarship, and we are very thankful for him and his service for the college. So I guess we're going to open it up for questions, if we have any.
They mentioned that teachers had the choice of going with kind of traditional professional development or the PLC. Do you find that, are there still some people that opt for the traditional professional development programs, or are they?
They all still need to be part of a professional learning community.
Okay.
But in addition to, they can choose to go to workshops or do other types of work. And typically they've chosen, Bob Bardwell, superintendent, mentioned that they've chosen items that enhance what they've been learning in their professional learning community. So they're still all participating in the learning community.
One of the areas that was mentioned on one of the slides was fluent correction. Can you describe that for me, please?
Fluent corrections, thinking back to the clickers slide, you would go on and make a correction by giving the correct answer. When the the teacher was doing the activity with the sticky notes, she could correct, but then you keep going, you correct by giving the positive, but then you go back and recheck. So if I had known who missed that question on what you do in correcting declarative knowledge, I could go back and check to see if someone knew that you needed to provide the correct answer, and then go back and recheck.
So at the very end of that video, Bob Argo talked about it kind of being a two-way street. They obviously learned from you, but implied that you also learned from them. So I'm just wondering, what's the top thing each of you learned from them through this process?
During that interview, something that he was talking about is the fact that our students, he was involving our students, and what they learn is we place them in the field, in the classrooms, and with the teachers. But individually, what did we learn through the process? Is that what you're asking? I think that I learned the fact that teachers in the field still want to learn. That they continually, even though they had a lot going on last year, they had other things within the district, they were open and receptive to us and the knowledge that we were bringing to them. And I was very pleased to see that, that they were willing to learn, and then obviously they implemented things still, so that was meaningful.
I would say for me, as a person that lives in the community, I think it solidified my importance of staying involved in the community, especially the three of us having a background in education. On top of that, being able to use our insights and knowledge and resources and whatever it might be to support the community and allow us to have an impact on that. I would say that was the biggest thing I learned.
I think the biggest thing I learned had actually occurred the previous year when Lisa and I worked with teachers from Davenport on differentiating curriculum in co-taught classes. One of my fears when I left public education to come here was that you lose touch with what's happening in the field and you get in your little ivy tower. And ISBE is notorious for changing what they call things and acronyms. And what used to be the alternate standards is now called the essential elements. And you can't find those essential elements with the learning standards because they're placed in the assessment section of ISBE along with information on the alternative assessment. So that was the big learning.
Thank you very much.